Good afternoon, and thank you for coming to this conversation today with Cornelius van der Kooi from the Free University of Amsterdam. My name is Corey Wilson. I teach missiology at Calvin Theological Seminary, and we are on the heels of the Kuiper Conference here. We just finished the Kuiper Conference the last 2 days here at Calvin College and Calvin Seminary, and we are pleased to have many guests from around the world participating in that conference. And one of our guests is from the Netherlands, Kees van der Kooi. And so while he was here, we have many opportunities for him and his wife, Marquiet, to speak within the community, within the denomination, and then here also at Calvin College and Calvin Seminary. And so instead of a traditional lecture, we thought we would do an interview style with Kees, and then I will draw in Jim Bratt and then Marquiet van der Kooi about halfway through this conversation and bring in their perspectives on some topics related to some of the work and some of the interest of Kees. And so it's a delight and honor to have my PhD advisor from the Free University here with us, and who has been a wonderful mentor to me. And it's wonderful for me to introduce him to many of you here in the community. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Kees van der Kooi to you. Kees was a minister in the Reformed Church of Leimuiden. Leimuiden. My Dutch is niet zo goed. Yeah. I have 6 weeks there in Kampen this fall, so maybe it'll be a little bit better, improved. He got his PhD from the Free University. He studied the way of thinking of the young Karl Barth. He was also a Fulbright scholar and spent some time here in Wisconsin in the United States. He was the head of the Department of Dogmatics and Ecumenics at the Free University for several years. He's written many books, and some of the more recent ones were this one here, This Incredibly Benevolent Force, which came out of his Warfield lectures at Princeton. It was translated into English in 2018, this year. And then Christian Dogmatics, an Introduction, that he wrote with Gijsbert van den Brink, translated into English in 2017, but originally published in the Netherlands in 2011. It has been through several...
Five prints
already. So this is a wonderful... systematic theology introduction. And so we're going to have a conversation around these two books, but also some of the themes, some of the topics from these two books, and some of the relevance to us. And so there's many things we're going to hopefully cover this afternoon in the next hour. A little bit, let me just say this. I'll introduce her more later, but Marquiet van der Kooi is a chaplain of almost 40 years. She works as a hospital chaplain at a psychiatric hospital in the Netherlands. She'll be joining this conversation, as will Professor Emeritus Jim Bratt. He will be joining this conversation. He served as one of the translators of Christian Dogmatics, and they both have some interesting perspectives to add to this conversation. But real briefly, and I don't know how Dutch this is, but a quick personal note in terms of what Kees means to me. I grew up broad evangelical, and so I'm a newcomer to the Reformed tradition as an adult. And there's nothing more obnoxious sometimes than a convert. And I converted as a broad evangelical. I'm still evangelical, but came into the Reformed tradition and met people like Kees van der Kooi, and brought me into a tradition that is very deep and yet at the same time winsome and engaged. And there was nothing off limits for us to think about, to reflect on. And so that both that notion of rootedness, but also the ecumenical vision was really nurtured by Kees. And as someone growing up in California, a broad evangelical, I found in people like Kees and Rich Mao and others, a Reformed theology that I can make my way in this tradition. This is definitely a place for me to make a home. Another thing that I really appreciate about Kees van der Kooi is that he takes the world as it is, not as we want it to be, but we must first come to terms with the world, with all its beauty and its brokenness. And whether we're dealing with people or with culture, we don't have the luxury of starting where we want things to be or where we think they should be. We have to begin with the realities that are around us in the world. And so I found that very refreshing. And one of the things that in my own dissertation work, I was interviewing many people about their experiences of the Christian tradition. And I remember sitting in your office, Case, talking about how I wanted to do this dissertation, to do a theology of work, but really engaging not just texts, but the lives of people. And you stopped me and you said, Corey, I want you to not just look at these interviews with these dozens of people, not just as a sociological exercise, but as a task or a chore, a privileged role of trying to discern the Holy Spirit's work in their lives. And what that opened up for me was a way of being a theologian, but with pastoral sensitivities, that this was not just an intellectual, theological, cognitive exercise, but a prayerful, spiritual exercise as well. And that's something that I found in your work as inspiration and kind of forging a path forward that that I hope to expose my students to, and I hope to follow in that train. So that's a little bit about my relationship with Dr. Van der Kooi. So Dr. Van der Kooi, the first thing I want to talk about is your text, Christian Dogmatics. And I'm wondering what gave rise to this this textbook. Why do we need another textbook in dogmatics? And so, what are you seeking to do in this text that that would justify writing another book?
Now, it came out of the many years of teaching at the Vrije Universiteit. We used as a textbook Hendrikus Burkhoff, Christian Faith, and we added texts from sometimes from Burkhauer to it, but. In the late 90s, I would say, we became increasingly unhappy with some of the elements of Hendrikus Burkhoff. And okay, then you add something to it, and that had to do with with Trinitarian theology. We added it to it. And finally, we thought, okay, there is also a new generation of students. Burkhoff gives Latin not translated, and he gives German, and even my students, that is too bad, but they know English, but few of them know German. So that is really a difference, and we have also less time. That is also something that I regret. In our system, we had in former times, we had 4 years, and now we have we took over the Anglo-Saxon system of a bachelor and master, and that meant that we had 3 years for our bachelor. So less time, and we have to adapt and to adjust to that new situation. But particularly because there were theological topics that were not in Burkhoff or not so developed there. And not of a sudden, but I even don't know when exactly. I think in about 2006, then with Gijsbert and me together, we got the idea, okay, we think we have to write it by ourselves. And okay, after so many years, you feel also that you have the experience to do that. Okay, I found a wonderful colleague in Gijsbert because he has more knowledge of science and theology and in some of the more philosophical questions. I'm less experienced in that, but nevertheless, I know something of it. And I have also my own fields where I had gone, where I had digged into. For example, the pneumatology. But okay, so then we decided, and also public theology. So then we decided, okay, we will set up a whole new textbook. And we have tried to make it or to write it in a way that it is not discernible which author has written the first draft of which chapter. Maybe sometimes you can find some features of it, but we have written it together. Yeah, if you have 16, if you have to make 16 paintings, and you set up 16 boards, and you say, okay, you make the first draft for that chapter, and so we divided it, and then we discussed it and went over it, and we filled in or we rewrote some topics, and that has been very fruitful. So this book has, I think we have written it in about 4-5 years. Yeah, but so it was necessary to write a new book for a new generation students. And also the situation in our church, in our culture has changed. And the renaissance of Trinitarian theology was a reason to set it up again. And I think also when we think about a more empirical attitude, so systematic theology is not only, in my view and our view, top down, that we give a system, but we reflect on practices, on faith, on church, on liturgy, on what Christians do in society. So many of the questions come much more up from, I would say, grassroots. So that I think what you can discern in our book is a little bit a different understanding of the task of systematic theology. And what we also wanted to do is, and we found that already in the book of Hendrikus Burkhoff, which is very open, and it lays open the questions. What we wanted to do, that we try to make students thinking, not deciding everything. But there are issues and topics in theology that way can go different avenues, and we wanted to lay open those avenues. Okay, we also make decisions by ourselves, but not after we have tried to stimulate the reader to think for him or herself. So that is a little bit of the atmosphere that we have tried to bring in. I would say also this book reflects the influence of evangelical theology, of, I would say, charismatic strains, and the combination with a Reformed tradition. And we hope that it has given a vibe that is attractive.
That comment reminded me of something that Carl Bosmus mentioned to me a couple years ago. I asked him what he liked about studying with Birkhauer, G.C. Birkhauer. And he said, I found in Birkhauer, he taught us the questions to which Louis Birkhoff had only told us how to memorize the answers. And so getting at the questions from which, you know, the theology was an answer to. And I hear an echo of that as well in your work. Talk to us a little bit about what is the relationship between the Warfield lectures, this incredibly benevolent force, and Christian dogmatics. What themes do you pick up there? I know you deal a lot with pneumatology there, and maybe even just speak to, is there a gap? I mean, you're Reformed and charismatics, and those two usually don't go together. those two phrases. And so talk to us a little bit about this incredibly benevolent force and how it fills a gap and takes further your argument or your work in the dogmatics.
Yeah, I'm a strange author because I have written on Karl Barth, and I don't despise him. And I have written on the charismatic theology, or I would say pneumatology. So now these Warfield lectures came upon after having given those lectures upon a invitation from Princeton. But it gave me the opportunity to elaborate a little bit on what it means when we look at the at some of the topics in Christian theology, in dogmatics, from the perspective of the work of the Holy Spirit. And to my, I think that here is a very promising avenue. I can also mention Van Ruler, who already gave some wonderful clues here. I can also mention here Abraham Kuyper himself, who wrote his work on the Holy Spirit. And I think there are possibilities also in the Heidelberger Catechism, in which we speak about word and spirit. Yeah, the Lutherans speak about word. The Reformed is to speak about word and spirit. That is something different. So here, in this dynamic field of the work of the Spirit and how the Spirit brings us to Christ, attaches us to Christ, and Christ attaches us to the Father, there are these are avenues that can be applied to the Old Testament. To I would say I am on my way to find pneumatology of the Holy Spirit as a broad denominator for the whole of theology, without losing the Trinitarian structure. But the Holy Spirit is already at work in creation. It is at work in Christ, and that is very promising and even a challenge. Yeah, if you look at the life of Jesus Christ from the perspective of pneumatology, then you have there the filial language, Son, and the pneuma language, pneumatic language, yeah, filled, anointed by the Spirit, and our confessions speak about it, that we are participants, we are receptive participants in that anointment. Now, okay, what does that mean for the life of our communities? What does that mean for our life? But particularly for Christian life in church, but also in society. Now, here are possibilities to look again and anew to Christology, which I have done in some way in these lectures, and also to have a look at the history of Reformed theology. So I have there a whole chapter on the Holy Spirit and transformation, or societal transformation, and then I discuss Calvin and Schleiermacher and Kuyper, because I think there is a close link between the three of them. And of course then this boils down to the task of the discernment of the spirits. And I think that is also a discussion that we have to do with the Pentecostal movement, with Pentecostals, but also in our church, in society, in politics, the discernment of the spirits. One of the critics on our book was from Charles van Engen. Many of you know him, and he talked about the possibility of a Spanish translation. But then he said, you should bring in more Mary and spirits. We are too modern in that way, yeah? That we are hesitant to speak about spirits, about, okay.
More work to do. So you mentioned, so there's a lot in there, and I'm tempted to have you talk a little bit more about, when you talk about the work of Christ and then the work of the Spirit in creation, often people will say that that's leading us down the mainline Protestant path, and we're giving away too much in terms of losing the centrality of Christ and of Scripture. So actually, maybe just say, how do you understand that you talk about borrowing from Irenaeus, the mission of the Son and of the Spirit of the two hands of God. Can you just talk about how those two, in your understanding, relate? Because I think it has a lot to do with when we think about discerning the Spirit's work in the world. I think there's something in there to maybe answer some of the fears, or at least give some guidance to some of the fears that would say, no, let's just focus on the work of the Spirit in the church and leave the stuff in the world for, someone else.
Yeah, sometimes I was afraid that I think, okay, in my concentration on the work of the Spirit, am I losing the concentration on Christ? Doing theology is always a riskful undertaking. If it is not, it is boring, and it has nothing to do with the church and the real life. But life is in the risk, and God has brought us in that riskful life. I will even speak tomorrow at Acton with the title God as Entrepreneur. Okay, that's a dangerous title. But so, I cannot say that I always avoid one-sidedness, but at the same time, as you already mentioned, Irenaeus speaks about those two hands of God. The Gospel of John speaks about the two missions, and at the same time, it is very clear that the Holy Spirit points to Jesus and wants us to bring into the life, the eschatological life that Jesus already is now. And we are not yet there. Yeah? We are under the promise. There is a promissio for us. And we are partakers of that in faith, in spe. The Spirit is sent, is poured out in order to draw us in that life that is embodied and fulfilled already in Jesus Christ, but not yet fulfilled in us. We are still underway, and even Karl Barth in his late work that's very inconsequential in his theology, writes somewhere that Jesus is still a fighter and is on his way and not yet at the end of his works. Okay, how that is fitting in his theology, and that is, I think, that's a tension here. But it's a fruitful tension. So, yes, word and spirit. So word is finally Jesus Christ, and the Spirit wants us to draw to Christ, who is and was the same and will be forever, and he will be at work. So we cannot neatly discern between here the Son and the Spirit. They are discernible, but so here the work of dogmatics is on a systematic level is a kind of stuttering. And but in practical life, we are brought in the communion with the Father and the Son by the Spirit. So you always have to speak in more than one word. I think that is liturgical. So the liturgy, the liturgical language and practice, that makes and that that is the basis and the substance of our theological reflection. We have to think about that. What are we doing when we pray? What is happening now? Okay, so and theology has then only a very modest task to guide that whole process of praying, of living, of acting in church and society. A modest, but also sometimes correcting a task. Yeah, not only correction, and not only a normative task, but also to give orientation. Mm-hmm. Orientation. If we can say, due to the what the Bible says about God and Christ and the pouring out of the Spirit, that God is not yet at the ends of his works. Okay, then it suddenly becomes very, then we are somewhere in that game. We are on the stage and he wants us to be involved in it. So here the whole issue of vocatio, calling, comes in. And the meaning of life, meaning of bringing up children, etc., etc. Okay.
So that vision of theology is not just looking to the past and guarding and passing on what has been handed to us, but also, in so doing, equipping us through the liturgy, through teaching, through discipleship, for the capacity to discern the Spirit's work today, and bringing the tradition that's been handed down into conversation in the same light or the horizon as looking to seeing what new work the Spirit is doing in the world today. And we see that even in the book of Acts. As soon as the gospel goes from one culture to the next, it raises all new theological questions that the disciples, Jewish followers of Jesus, didn't have to encounter before. And that vision of theology, of doing our work in terms of the tradition that's been handed down, but for the, like you said, the life, the worship, the prayer, the mission of the church today, that's I find that very compelling. And I wonder if you could draw in, since you've mentioned this before, why Kuiper and why Bart? I mean, how can you be Kuiperian and Bartian? And at least in the United States, those two do not go together. I want to ground this and say, how does Bart help equip the church for this task of stewarding the tradition, but also discerning the Spirit's work in the world?
That is an invitation to a whole lecture series, I would say.
Give us a teaser.
Yeah, I give you a teaser. It is not only discernment of the spirits of the Holy Spirit, but it's also discernment of the evil spirits. And I think in that way, Karl Barth has done a great job. That he has brought to the attention of the church a concentration of Jesus Christ as the one world in a situation in which the nation, Germany, was under the spell of Nazism. And there are other countries also today who are under the spell of nationalism. Yeah. If it is about idolatry, then I think that Bart has done very deep things. And I think also when he how it relates together. Now both are great theologians and both see all the questions. And they come to it from different ways, but they at least see the questions. And they given some answer to it. So I think that in an age of secularism, Karl Barth has given a counterproposal, to a culture in which Max Weber said, okay, we do Wissenschaft without God. That is Wissenschaft. And Karl Barth said, not at all. Every decent thinking could start with the acknowledgement of God. So it is a bold counter proposal in a time of secularization over against Nietzsche. And Kuiper was also very aware in his times of the 19th century, in which he called paganism, in which Christianity was no longer the only choice for a culture. And he was the first one to acknowledge that our Dutch nation was no longer only a Christian nation, but that there was a deep division. So Kuiper, in his way, has given an answer in a situation in which the 19th century and the 20th century has gone the path of atheism. Kuiper was the first one to introduce Nietzsche in our Dutch discussion. But of course, the more important fact for the genius of the genius of Kuiper. Kuiper is the great genius. Bavinck has called him always himself as a student of Kuiper, and of course Kuiper is terrible. He was not a kind man, I think. But okay, the kindness is not always the asset that you need in theology. Of course, he has tried to connect the Reformed tradition to modernization, to modern culture, in which the church is only one of the institutions in the society. And he has done that in a very creative way. From Kuiper, the famous quote, of course, everybody knows that in this room, I think, is that there's no inch where Jesus Christ, not Christ, mine, yeah? And Karl Barth says, Gott geht aus Ganze. God is about everything. And that kind of claim on complete life is also in Karl Barth. And about the Holy Spirit, I think Kuiper wrote on the Holy Spirit, and later he developed that, I think, in his theory of common grace, because it is a theological theory. Karl Barth, in his way, has given a theology in which also ethics has finally to do with listening, preparation, preparing the people for listening to the word of God, and preparing the church for listening to the word of God, and always be dependent on the Holy Spirit. You can also look or describe the theology of Karl Barth as a theology of the Holy Spirit. His first works were sermons that were titled, it was published under Sucht Gott, so werdet ihr leben. Search for God, then you will live. Or Uh, Veni Creator, Kom Schöpfergeist. That's another sermons in the 20s, yeah, or in Kom Schöpfergeist, come Holy Spirit, come life-giving Creator Spirit, Veni Creator Spiritus. And later in the when he was in his old age, when he was preaching in the prison of Basel, also those sermons are very it is theology is depending, or that we heard the word of God is depending on the work of the Holy Spirit. That is very, that is even a little bit irritating in his work, I think. Yeah.
Irritating to you? Or
also to me, and because he, sometimes you think, now it escapes me again, and at you never become very concrete, but it is as if this theology brings the people till the end of what he can do, preparing them for listening, attentiveness.
So am I right in saying with that Bart wants to pull back our control to stand over Scripture, to stand over that revelation by preparing us for receptivity to the Spirit, for that illumination to take place? I want to draw in at this point Dr. Jim Bratt and then Marguerite van der Kooi, if they'd come up and join us up here. No, you stay up. You stay up here. Yeah. We're going to pass the mic back and forth. So as I mentioned, Marguerite van der Kooi, she's been a chaplain at a psychiatric hospital for almost 40 years. She's what? Okay, at a hospital for almost 40 years. She's also written on many topics such as hope, grief, dealing with children who go a different way, and most recently in a co-authored book that's going to be translated this next year, hopefully.
We hope so.
Yeah, Good Tools Are Half the Work, The Role of Theology in Pastoral Care and Spiritual Care. And then also, as many of you know, Professor Jim Bratt, he was professor emeritus here at Calvin College, and delighted to have him also teaching at the seminary now. Dr. Bratt served as one of the translators on the Christian Dogmatics. And so, Jim, I'd like for you to talk to us a little bit about what was your encounter with this work. You had to spend a lot of time with it and with the translation. So how did you encounter this systematic theology, and what is your experience with it?
I did not translate from raw from the Dutch. I had a translation already done, and I translated it into native-born first language American idiom. And it was a great joy to do it. The last time I had encountered systematic Reformed theology that closely was my senior year in high school. So we're talking the autumn of 1966. I'm 17 years old. You know what 17-year-old guys are like. And we encountered Reformed theology as God's finished truth at the hands of Louis Burkhoff's Manual of Reformed Doctrine. And it was, it nearly cost my faith. I'm not kidding. We began by reading about the communicable and incommunicable attributes of God. And later on, here at Calvin, when I encountered the thought of Ludwig Feuerbach, I understood exactly what Feuerbach was talking about. In the beginning, man creates God in his own image. So when I open Case's book, and we begin with the Trinity, and we begin with, we see theology as answer to our existential questions. It reminded me of why I really prefer the Heidelberg Catechism to the Westminster Standards. It's existential, it's personal, it's pastoral. And it was, I don't say it brought me back to faith, because I had long, by the operation of the Holy Spirit, come back. But it was so winsome. So inviting. And I think the Trinitarian approach also, this is the first time I had ever read through Reformed theology on a Trinitarian approach. It solved a lot of intellectual problems. So I was translating along and, wow, you know, that makes sense. So it was very effective that way. And it was also great to work for a friend. I felt honored to be collaborative that way.
I just want to read one passage real quick. I should have asked you, do you have a favorite passage or anything like that? I know of, but I want to read just a little sampling of a passage here on the Holy Spirit that speaks to the deep theological, but also the existential needs. Maybe kind of when I read this, I thought of your comment about kind of the Heidelberg-ish. It says, in summary, the pairing of Word and Spirit recognizes that God wants us to become alive through all the objective gifts of Bible, story, and the work of the church and its proclamation, rites, and diaconate. Detached from this life-giving work of the Spirit, all these media remain inert. The Christ remains outside of us, disconnected. The Spirit brings Christ towards us. Rather, the Spirit brings us to Christ and incorporates us into the body of Christ. The Spirit of God thus ensures that the Word of God, the promise, the new life comes to us. And in this life, this was like a morning meditation almost for me. The Spirit ensures the experience of being touched, of an existential relationship of participation and encounter. The Spirit does not rest until we are truly involved in God's turning toward us and responding to it. So beautiful. I don't know if that speaks to some of what you were, gives you a little taste of why you should buy the book. So there's no dry. Someone said that you leave Louis Burkout out in the rain for a week or whatever. You wait, you come back, it's still as dry as cardboard or something like that. Anyway, there may be a descendant of Louis Burkhoff in here, and I just offended them, and I apologize. I want to draw Marcrete, you into this, and I want you most recently co-authored the book with Case, but it comes out of much of your work as a chaplain. And so I wonder how and what ways does, you know, you argue in your book that chaplains need to read systematic theology. They need to be equipped with the tools of theology. But at the same time, it's not just a one direction endeavor, that your work as a chaplain also informs or affects theology. And so I can, you know, I've sat in your home and heard the conversations between the two of you. And but in what ways? So can you give us an example of how good theology has helped you as a chaplain, but also how your work as a chaplain has impacted even some of the conversations or the theology that from our tradition?
Yeah, well, I'm a little concerned about my profession because I see that a lot of the work that we as chaplains do, and that is important, of course, that we know something about psychology and so, and interventions, that's very important. But that's not the core business. The core business is that we are theologians. And when people ask for a pastor, they don't ask for a social worker or a psychologist. We need to be good, solid theologians. And I have the great pleasure to be married with someone the first 20 years of our marriage, we did not talk so much about theology because we had four children to, almost never, we had four children to raise. But when they left the house, there were many more opportunities to talk about what I experienced in the hospital. And then we discussed about how I did things. So one of the big things is that I meet often Islam people. They don't ask for someone who is trying to get them converted, but they ask for someone who is close to them. And we talked a lot about Islam and Christianity. Is it the same God? Is it different? So that is one of the things I think that was very fruitful to talk about. It's not something academic. It is life, through life. Another topic is also, in our times, people are getting much older than in former times. So the aging thing is a big topic. How to deal with getting older, getting more vulnerable. It's nice that we are getting older, but how to deal with all the end of life issues? You can be very secure about this and that, the two of us think it is better to engage those topics theologically.
Is aging a challenge, or is it just an accident? Is it a challenge from God to think about it, to reflect on it? Or, is it just something that happens in our modern medicine-filled culture? So there are new fields that we have to reflect on theologically. And that it is a new situation in our culture that we, most of us, will be relatively healthy until 60, and then there will be more years, and then suddenly some of the restrictions come. But nevertheless, life goes on. For many of us, for some not, but so this whole issue of aging is some of the new fields in which Christian theology has, I think, not been urged to think yet, and we should do that. So that is one of the issues that came up between us.
So the question, what does God want to say to you in this situation? Being 10 or being 60 or being 90. Another new thing is also thinking about the climate things, the environment things, and that's also in a hospital. Those are things that has to be thought about. And sick people are not only thinking about themselves. I feel that many sick people have a kind of extra antenna, sensitivity for things that are around in the world that they are feeling concerned about. When they are in not too much pain, there is a wonderful sensibility for other things, and we talk about that. And that this is a new topic too.
You have to also get the humor, the great winsome humor that Marguerite in particular in these episodes in the book brings to the case. My favorite is the one where she's confronted by clinically psychotic older man who is Muslim, and he reveals to Marguerite that God has revealed to him that this patient is going to be the sire of a new blended race that will bring together Christianity and Islam and solve the problem, and that she, Marguerite, had been chosen to be the mother. and Marguerite, I just love her reply, well, in my Christian tradition, when God wants two people to do something, he reveals his will to both of them. And he has not yet revealed this to me. Oh, man, that was just a brilliant stroke. But that's typical Marguerite.
Marguerite, do you have any story that you want to share to illustrate that? Not maybe that story, but another story that some encounter with a patient, with somebody that is cause you to stop and reflect and to think, even to spill over in conversations when you come home with case that has been, that somehow God has spoke to you or that has shaped you as a chaplain and a theologian.
Oh, sure, I have many. I have hundreds of them. I remember talking with a woman, an elderly lady who had been working all her life, first for her parents, to bring them to an end. And then her parents-in-law, schoonouders, in-laws. So those were four. And then she had the brother of her husband who had an accident. So she worked all her life to help people to live, and she was exhausted when I met her in the hospital. And she said, they only want to have me when I work for them. I'm a kind of Martha and I hate it. So I brought that story of Maria and Martha. It is a beautiful story, but it's also a story that many, especially women, hate because of the feeling like we work and we work and we have to work because there's a lot of work that has to be done. The laundry has to be done, the eating and so on. And in the end, we are with, our hands are empty because then they say on the end that is not the most important thing to do. So this woman also, thank you, Jesus, yeah. So when we started our conversation and she talked about being Martha and hated to be that, I brought up an exegesis that I like very much from Meister Eckhart. He says is probably the misunderstanding of Martha that she was only loved because she worked, and was the good understanding of Maria that she had a feeling like I don't have to work for the love of Jesus. So could it be that that you are loved because you're you and because you just receive the grace instead of starting at the other end by I have to work for it? And that I saw that in our conversation, she got that it is in the hands of Jesus. You're not supposed to work to be loved, but you're loved because you know that you cannot add any grace to your life. And I know that many people have the experience that they need to be to do a lot to work to be loved. There are many stories about mothers and children, fathers and children, spouses, how you're in church. Do I do enough to be important enough to be here? So could it be that is the core of this story, that Martha misunderstood that thing? So it's not about that her work is not important, but because you must say, if I'm right, it's Eckhart who says it, and I like it. That's because the work is okay, but that's not the way that you're important for Jesus. Well, I like that, and she liked that, so that helped. Is it a?
Yeah. It was a relief. Yeah.
So one of the things I'm excited about in terms of introducing Case and Marcrete to my students, but also I think for our conversation here, is from this most recent book that's going to be translated, is the Art of Listening, and the theologians and chaplains and your stories. From conversations and what I've read, attune us to be better listeners to the real cries, the laments, the issues that are going on in people's lives before we seek to speak and to do our theological reflection. So I want to open it up for a couple minutes. If we have a question from the audience or two, please raise your hand. Yeah.
Bavinck wrote Gereformeerde Dogmatik, and Karl Barth wrote first Christian, christliche Dogmatik, then later kirchlich dogmatics, the church dogmatics. What is the reformed element in your Christian dogmatics?
I would say it is fully reformed as to the content. As soon as we start, we say that we come from a reformed tradition and that we are not ashamed of that, to say that openly, and that also gives a restriction. We are coming from Europe, from the Northern Hemisphere, so... But what is reformed in our theology? Now, I would say this concentration finally on God. God as the subject, God in his honor, God as the director, and we are the recipients of his grace and of this life. We will never be in his director's room. So there is a deep, that is a reformed, I would say, attitude. And I can also say, okay, the concentration on this listening, what I said, word and spirit, the deep Trinitarian structure. Yes, if reformed is not only an identity that was formed in the past, but reformed is semper reformanda, and it is again listening to the word of God, to the triune God himself, and try to do your theological task in your generation. And that means that you have to listen carefully to the past and to what our former generations have given to us. Yes, we are very grateful for it. But we, in our place, in our times, have the responsibility to do the job again, to listen and to think for ourselves. That is reformed.
The work of the Holy Spirit is so often vague and background and not explicit and enabling and mediating and so forth. Do you think that female images might be more helpful than male images for the Holy Spirit? That is, to define it or to describe the Holy Spirit as in a more feminine than a more masculine way.
I don't think so. I think that you need a lot of images, and there are some feminine and other masculine. Also, the whole metaphor of God as Father is masculine. And so no, I wouldn't say, and I also would a little bit object to the fact that you say Holy Spirit is often so vague. No, when the Word of God becomes very concrete for us, that is the Holy Spirit. When yeah, it brings us. The work of the Spirit brings us to God himself, to the triune God himself, and to his commandment, and but that is always, it becomes concrete, If you mean that the Holy Spirit does not point to itself or himself or herself, or how to say that, that it is the power or the agent that brings us to the work of Christ or to the work of the Father, yes, then it is, you can say, but that is not fake. That is something that you that then we have to say the what the Holy Spirit does is make very substantial, concrete what God is, what life is, what his commandment in a given situation is. Maybe I can give one example. When you are very busy and but there is someone who or you're in my case a grandchild wants something and comes in and wants me to listen. Okay, what do I do then? Am I only in a hurry, or is it that I think no, now be here attentive? So I would say what the Holy Spirit teaches me is attentiveness, being attentive to this or that. Now, okay, that is not vague to my understanding, but maybe I do not understand you well. Okay, I'm sorry.
You do deal with the biblical account, some male, neuter, and feminine. So you do recognize.
Yeah, oh yeah, sure. But there is a wide range of metaphors, and we should not stick to one metaphor, as the scriptures do not stick to one metaphor. If you look at Jesus in his gelijkenis and the parables. That is a huge range of metaphors, and they are all usable. The Psalms. Yeah? Okay.
Would you join me in thanking our guests this afternoon? And there are references there to the books that you can purchase. I encourage you to look to Erdman's or wherever you buy your books from. Also, I want to give a thanks to the Calvin Institute for Christian Worship for co-sponsoring this afternoon's interview and conversation. And thanks to Cindy, to Kristen, Kathy, and John for hosting us here at the Meter Center. And have a wonderful spring afternoon.